Thank you, Rich and Sandy. So we're going to do a blessing with a missions offering. It's just that, an offering. But let me tell you something. You can't go wrong giving to missions. God will bless you. But there is no sacrifice without obedience. So that's why the Bible refers to tithes and offerings. This is an offering. It's a free will offering. And if you would help us. Iowa is a small district in the Assemblies of God, and our Iowa missionaries, which the farthings are, depend on the Iowa churches. And so they're back home a little bit, because while they're in Bolivia the last 4 or 5 years, there are a few churches that have struggled. They've dropped their monthly support. And also you rebuild to, because a missionary doesn't just have a salary, but they provide the budget like a church to do the ministries that they do. Okay, and so I would urge you to give today, make a check to the church. If you don't have a check, you're not ready, you can give online. Or if you have a $5 bill, everything that goes in this offering, the reason we did it separate, because we can keep it separate, put it in a bag, they'll get every nickel, the change, a dollar, $5, $10. And with this many people, you'd be surprised. Last week, we had a wonderful missionary couple going to Cambodia, gave them $6,000. Isn't that amazing? That's awesome. So this week, let's give. And I've already given in the early service, so don't think I'm all talking, no go. I already gave. So ushers, come on and let's do it. And y'all, you that are here, y'all just be generous and God will bless you for it. I just pray right now for, I pray and you agree with me with your eyes open in prayer for the farthings in Jesus' name, for their peace, their grace, and the power of the Spirit, and for provision in every way for them and this offering that will bring glory to you, God, and more people would come to Christ in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me mention, they go in the bush. I mean, this guy is not your little sissy, okay, he's not a sissy missionary. This guy is a man's man. I mean, he goes places where he has to wrestle demon-possessed people and demon-possessed animals. He goes in the rugged places with a big four-wheeler going through streams and over mountains. I mean, this guy's an animal. Now, his wife, she's a sissy, but that's the way God made her, and that's okay, all right? So take your Bibles, turn to Ephesians at chapter number 5. And I'm going to put this microphone over here because I forgot to give it to Pastor Jeff. Pastor Jeff starts a series next week called The God of My Days. God is with us, God is for us, and God can do anything. 3-week series on Sunday morning, don't miss it. Next Sunday night, Pastor Hawkins, he's off preaching to some other church today. He abandoned us for another church. So you give him a hard time. I hope he's got his little hanky in his pocket in that church so he can anoint them with the hankies that he wears. But Pastor Hawkins on Sunday nights, the first 3 Sundays in March, is doing a series from Romans chapter 8. And Romans chapter 8 is the richest single chapter in the Bible. And Pastor Hawkins is one of the best theologians and best speakers you've ever heard in your life. You wonder, why do we have church on Sunday night? Because you have the world 5-6 days a week and you need more of God's people, more of the word, and more of worship. That's why we do it, because you don't get enough of it. So there, that's enough of that secondary sermon. All right, now let's get into the Bible. Ephesians chapter 5. I'm surprised y'all came back after last week. Ladies, how many of you, I straightened your man out last week. Just raise your hand. 2. Very good. I didn't look over here. Oh, my goodness. I hope that you guys are doing good over here. Ephesians chapter number 5. Ephesians 5 gets a bad rap. It's a tough book. And it's been taught wrong for a long time. And, you know, preachers and teachers, they do this thing, and it almost encourages male dominance, and it's different. Listen, when the Bible says a wife submits to her husband as unto the Lord, this is talking about spiritual leadership, and not sitting back in your big chair, snapping your finger, barking orders, bring me some coffee and the newspaper. It's not what it's about at all. And you read the whole thing. If you didn't get here last week, go back and listen. If you weren't here, go back online and listen to 2 weeks ago, the original fallen family, and how when Adam and Eve, who was at that time called female Adam, when they took of that tree and sin entered, it broke their relationship, and how men and women are by nature at war at each other. They contend. Women contend with men. They don't. There's something changed in the relationships. And for all of us, what is Christianity about anything but relationship with God and with each other? And if you're not married, say, well, what am I doing here? So let me tell you something. The principles that I'm sharing today work in every other relationship between brothers and sisters, between you as a parent and your children. Listen at the Holy Spirit to speak individually to you, between you and your boss, or if you're the boss, to your employees. Okay, as one of the now two senior pastors, the one that's older and more bossy, me, I would say that I'm kind to our pastors. Okay, I believe I practice what I preach here as a boss. Okay, it's easier to do it there than it is with Susan, but last week I preached at y'all, but I wasn't listening too good. No, I'm just kidding. But this week, I'm trying to be better. This week, I'm trying to preach to the wives, but you men are going to get a little stuff too here. And if you're a female, you might get married. You might want to listen up too. All right, so here we go. We're going to read Ephesians 5 and try to get a hold of this correctly. Now, before verse 21, there's verse 18. How many of you know 18 becomes before 21? And verse 18 says, be ye filled, that's continuous action verb, be you continuously filled with the Holy Spirit, not drunk with wine where it is excess, but filled with the Spirit, and singing and praising and full of the joy of the Lord and worshiping God with all your heart. That is what you need to be the husband you need to be. Less flesh, less self, okay, more Jesus, more Spirit. That's what you need to be the wife you need to be, or the friend you need to be, or the son or daughter you need to be. You get this? Is less self, less flesh, more Jesus, and more Spirit. So this whole context is you can't do this without the fullness of God, without the fullness of the Spirit, be filled with the Spirit. And as you're full of the Spirit, verse 21 is not to men, or it's not just to women, it's to both men and women, both husband and wives, both children and grandparents, every person, no matter who you are, the single person. And it's this verse right here, chapter 5, verse 21. It says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, he hadn't even addressed husbands and wives. Submit to one another. This is an attitude that we carry in all relationship, submitting to one another and out of reverence for Christ. Notice the word reverence. Another word would be respect. Another word would be honor. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband's the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he's a Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. And then I'm going to just remind you from last week, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. And so you give yourself to your wife. So the answer for both women and men is to lay your life down first to Jesus and then for each other. That's how godly relationships and godly families happen. You jump to verse 33 in this passage, and here is a summary for both husbands and wives. First, however, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself. Each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself. That's the husbands. And the wife must respect her husband, or honor her husband, or reverence her husband. They're all saying the same thing, or to be proud of, or to speak highly of, okay? And to treat them with value in an honored way, okay? So that's a foundation of the things that I want to share with you here. And Paul is simply trying to tell us that men have needs and women have needs. And last week we talked about three needs of a woman to help our guys be better husbands. To cherished wives was the title, you remember? Women need communication, a deep connecting to the wife. The husband needs to communicate and be deeply connected inside, with a deeper communication and not just surface stuff. Wives want their husbands to lead, to be leaders. And that's what it's talking about. It's talking about the responsibility of a husband to lead and for a wife to cooperate with that leadership as if the person's leading with a godly way, like the Lord leads us, okay? And so not with a hammer and not with domination. And so leadership how? Well, leadership spiritually. Be in the church, open the Bible, praying together. Leadership with the children, taking responsibility for the kids' education and their discipline, not just pushing it all off on the wife. Not that she's not capable. Okay, that's not what it's saying. And then the next thing that I talked about was security. If a woman feels like that you're going to bail on her, she feels like that you're not committed, and she feels you give her words that things aren't going to be okay, she's going to shut down. So a woman needs to hear this. She needs to hear everything's going to be okay. I'm not going to leave. Don't worry. I love you. We're going to get through this. It's all going to be okay. We're going to stay together no matter what. I'm not going anywhere. I love the kids. I love you. Nothing's going to change. When you speak in insecure terms and make your wife feel insecure, she shuts down. She quits listening to you. There's a problem. So for a husband, they have needs too. And one of them is a wife that understands this whole submissive thing. Now, you read this word and right away it repels your flesh because it's misunderstood. But actually, notice verse 21 again talks both to men and women to submit to each other, right? And the word submission has got a bad rap. It says, first, submit to one another. The amplified in essence of the whole passage here by it adds the words, and so does the NIV for reverence of God or our honor or respect to as unto God. And we're called to submit to God, all believers, and to submit to one another. Or here's the way it's put: prefer one another in love. Parents, that's toward your kids. Kids toward your parents, toward your neighbor, toward your friend, toward a pastor to his people, the people to his pastor, one another, teenage friends to each other, prefer one another in love. To lay down our lives for Jesus and for one another is preferring one another. It's dying to yourself. That's all it is. Paul's saying what makes all relationships godly, every relationship, if you want it to be godly, is what makes a marriage and a family relationship godly, and that's submission. Now, a submarine is a boat that does what? Goes underwater. The original word for a marine refers to a boat on the water. The word sub means to go under. So submarine is a boat that goes under, right? So submission, the word sub is under. The word mission is what we're here for. And hopefully if you're godly, it's the mission of God for you. But when you, in submission, you put under your mission in preference to another person's mission. You see, when I will put my wife's mission above my own mission, God will double bless me and it will come back around and flow to me and make my mission much easier and will have it accomplished with authority and power. Because if we try to get what we want with a heavy hand and domination, it's going to backfire on us. So God calls us to prefer one another in love and submit. So men, you submit to your wife. You put your mission. I need to put, even as a pastor of this church, that my wife's calling matters most. And then it'll come back and she will return that. What you send out on the water, on the waves, will come back at you and it'll end up being a blessing. This is called preferring one another in love, like Jesus did. Jesus was in submission to the will of the Father. Remember when he was going to get crucified? What did he say? Lord, is there any other way? Can you let this cup of suffering and death that I've got to drink, can you let this pass? Is there any other way? And then he says, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That's what a man does to lead his family, and that's what a woman does back for her husband. You see, the husband's responsible to set the spiritual tone and to love first as Christ loved us, his wife, by laying his life down and loving her as Christ loved, who gave himself and died for us as a church. And the wife is to respond in reality, in true humility, in true surrender, in a sense of saying, I love you and I'm going to respond back to you laying your life. I'm not going to just use you and treat you poorly because you adore me and you cherish me beyond words, okay? I'm not going to do that. I'm just not going to do it. Hey, did you ask me for a cross from Christmas? Was that you? I remembered that. That is a miracle. That's a miracle. I knew that if I didn't give it to her now, I'd never remember it. It'd be in my pocket next 3 weeks from now. That wasn't part of the sermon. When I was a child, they would have labeled me ADHD. A little scattered. But in marriage, the best way to see your God-given mission fulfilled is to put your mission under the mission of your spouse. And so that's very important. Now, Pastor Jeff, you know why you love him? Because he's a man of submission. That's it. He prefers other in love. He's just like Chris Smith, Pastor Brian's mother, who went to be with the Lord, a godly woman. You don't want to talk about her. She wouldn't let you. She'd be upset. She wouldn't have liked her own memorial service because we were talking about her. That's Pastor Jeff. He just doesn't want me doing this, so I'm doing it just to annoy him, to prefer him in love. I'm just kidding. So, prefer one another in love. How do you honor your husbands? Ladies, just like I told the men last week, if you're going to honor your husband, you're going to love him the way that God wants you to love him, you got to lay your life down, because some of this does not come natural. It just doesn't. And so you got to lay your life down for Jesus first and lay your life down for your husband. Die to yourself to honor your husband and meet his needs. Now, the three needs today, we're going to have three needs of a husband. So wives, I'm talking mostly to you. The first one is companionship. Genesis 2:18, the NIV. The Lord God said, it's not good for a man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him, a helper. The message, which is a paraphrase, modern paraphrase, it says it this way, Genesis 2:18. God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I'll make him a helper, comma, a companion. A man wants companionship. Listen, a man needs companionship. Another word for companion here is playmate, okay? And the reason God made Eve was to give Adam a companion. And Adam wanted someone he could play with. You know, remember I told you last week, we're not sure, but he's running around with his scissors in the garden causing problems and playing with the monkeys and whatever he's doing. And God said, that's not good. This is not good. And I'm going to make him something that'll help him a lot. And guys, trust me, you're never raised until you get married. She has to finish raising you. Luke, good luck, buddy. Just keep on growing up, brother. Pastor Luke. And I'm just telling you, and so he made a woman. And they were a companion or a playmate. And he needs to have someone to do things with. You know, man needs something to do something with. So men love to have fun. How many of you ladies know men like, how many of you men like to have fun? Game nights, play board games, go play some ball, go to a ball game, go out fishing, go hunting. You like to have some fun, right? You like to wrestle with your wife. That's fun. Not fun to them, but it's fun to you. You know, why do you think, you know, listen, you walk in a room and there's a bunch of men sitting around and the kids are absolutely going bonkers. And you think, what's going on? Listen, the men made them go bonkers. They were razzing them, teasing them, playing with them, getting them all stirred up, probably feeding them sugar because they like to see them get that sugar high and that crazy. The wife has to walk in and fix that problem. And men, why do you think they buy their kids train sets Christmas time? So when the kids go to bed, they're down there playing with that sucker. No kidding, I put that in my notes today, and somebody sent a picture of their train set. I don't even know who it was, but I'm telling you, I got it on my phone. It's a picture of a train set, a full-grown man. I think he's in his 50s. I don't remember. So, I don't want to offend you guys. How many think that I'd take pleasure in offending you? Okay, maybe I do a little bit, okay? But it's not my goal here to be offended, but, you know, but men are, it's just for an example, like a illustration, men are a little bit like a dog. Yeah, they are. So I, you know, just try this sometime, ladies, with your husband. Just say to him, you want to do something fun? He'll go, yeah, yeah, yeah. Go get your ball. Go get your ball. Okay, okay. They're excited. They love you. They want companions. They want to play with you. They want to have fun. You understand that? They get excited. That's why they go off playing basketball or baseball or football or whatever they're doing, hunting, golfing. They like to play. And sometimes when they're not honored, they like to go to the golf because at least they'll hear on the golf course, good shot, great job. But at home, they don't feel that, you know. You're not doing a good job. They feel dishonored. And here's the thing, ladies. While they like to play, they'd rather do something with you. They want that companionship. And the reason we fall in love is because we do fun things together. And the reason we fall out of love, that feeling, is because we quit doing fun things together and our lives go different directions. So ladies, listen to me carefully. Lay your life down. Find something fun that your husband likes to do and get involved in it and do it with him. You'll make a lot of memories. It'll be wonderful. He will love it. And by the way, can I tell you something, ladies? Shopping is not fun. Now, for those of you that are visitors here, I wrote my own biblical book. It's called James. My name is James. James chapter 2. Verse 1. No, James, 2 James rather. Not James chapter. 2 James chapter 1. 2 James chapter 1 verse 1. The very first thing it says is shopping is not fun. It's the first verse in my book. But God made men different than women. I mean, how many of you ever heard of Daniel Boone? Oh, Daniel Boone was a man, was a real man. You ever heard of that? Uh-huh. Go ahead and shine your false teeth at me, you old people, if you know. Those pearly whites, I can tell they're false because they don't have any yellow on them, so don't you try not faking me out. Anyway, I'm going to tell you two stories about Daniel Boone. You tell me which one you believe. Daniel Boone wakes up, he goes outside his cabin, and he sees beautiful flowers here. He looks, he says, oh, beautiful flowers. That'll make some good poopery poopo. Whatever, I don't know, you know what I'm talking about. That smelly stuff. I know it's potpourri, I was just trying to make you laugh. Thank you, thanks for the help though. I need a woman to help me, thank you very much. Potpourri. Anyway, he sees it and he smells it, he's wonderful, and he goes out with his rifle in the woods. He sees a huge buck. He raises that rifle up, aims. He goes, oh, I just can't do it. I just can't. A tear come to his eyes. He said, that could be Bambi's dad. I just can't do it. He takes his rifle back. He goes back into the cabin. He goes inside. He puts it away, and he sews up some curtains for the windows that he's been meaning to do. Now, how many of you believe that story about Daniel Boone? Raise your hand. Anybody believe it? One idiot. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, here's another story. See, what do you think about this one? Daniel Boone wakes up. He goes outside with his rifle. He steps on the flowers as on his way out to hunt. He gets out there, and he sees a beautiful deer. In fact, it's Bambi herself, or himself. It's Bambi himself. And he raises up his gun, and boom, blows him away. He guts him, fires up the fire, eats a little bit, and heads back with the rest back to the house to bring his food to his kids and family. How many of you believe that story? Because men are different than women. Now, I understand there's a generalization. And by nature, I was raised with a dad that didn't have guns. I wasn't around guns. I don't, you know, one time I had a gun. I scared the pastors. They were teaching me how to shoot it. And I went, so you shoot it like this, and it goes boom, like that. And they all hit the deck. Remember, Pastor Brett? You thought you were going to die, didn't you? You hit the ground. So keep guns away from me. They're scary with me. But my son, I don't know if he does because I've never seen him since he's an adult without clothes on, but I'll bet you he's got hair on every inch, curly, long, thick hair, every inch of his body because he's the man of all mans, and he hunts deer. He shoots anything. My grandson's favorite meat is deer meat, venison. That's it. That's not to clap at. Okay. Yeah, if you want to. That was the man that did that. So I'm just saying we're different, you know? We're different. You know, because God made us that way, we talk about how difficult it is, remember, for men to connect to their emotions. Why? Why did God make them difficult to connect to you? So we can kill things. You know, years ago, there was no Hy-Vee to go buy your meat. You killed that stuff. You gutted it. You brought it in. It was bleeding. A man's got he has a protective measure too. And you come in, you ask a real man, they're going to mess with your daughter, going to mess with your family. You got some men, and I do too, by the way. Don't come to my house because I'm wild with that thing. It's a six shooter, the big Texas long six shooter. And I'm telling you right now, you mess with one of my kids or mess with my wife, mess with my grandkids, feel your rear with something. I'll tell you that right now. Right? I mean, how many men you rear? Yeah. Right? Yeah. That's right. You let them know you got their back. But one of man's greatest needs is companionship. Why did God make him to need companionship? So that after he kills that deer, he'll go back home. Otherwise, he'd be sitting out in the woods. He'd be thinking, now, is there something I'm supposed to be doing right now? He'd forget. No, he wants companionship. And that's one of his big needs. The second need, I really struggle with whether I should share it or not, but it's not a weekend seminar, and that would be where I might be a little bit. I'm going to be careful how I word this, but it is a word the world has made dirty, that's really a sacred word, and that needs, we don't want our kids to hear it in dirty places and be taught by people that are immoral about this. But one of the great needs of a man is sex, and it's a sacred thing, sexual intimacy. It's a great need for men. God, I don't know why God made it that way, but it is. And that's why it's called holy matrimony, right? We come and we consummate holy matrimony. And so perhaps this might be another reason why Daniel Boone, after he shot and gutted the deer, went back home. Maybe that's another reason that he was going back home. I don't know. But the same way, ladies, that you need from your man communication, men have a need for sexual intimacy. And I don't know why God didn't make our needs to match. If there was a survey done, and the number two need of a man was sex. In that same survey, for sex for a woman, it was number 13, right behind gardening, number 12. Number 13, guys. Right? Just saying. So a woman needs to understand a man needs sexual affection. We hear things through our own needs, okay? For instance, another need of a woman I didn't mention last week is to have non-sexual affection, to be held. Get that? How many of you women, raise your hand and say, that's right. It doesn't always have to lead because you feel like an object. It doesn't always have to lead there. You just want to be loved for you and not feel like an object, okay, for sexual pleasure. And so that's another need of a woman. So a man says, I need sex. And she hears, oh, he just needs to be held. No, he doesn't need to be held. He needs sex. It's not true. You hear things through your own needs. That's not what he's saying. And when a woman says, I need to be held, he thinks she's coming on to me. and who can resist, right? Don't deceive yourself. Yes, she can resist. And you know what? I didn't really want to talk about it, but it's too important of a need not to. And too often this need is not being met. And unfortunately, the world's telling us how to get the need met. The world's addressing it in their twisted and sinful way. But this is a sacred, God-given, valid need for a man. And guys, I want to tell you something here. Even though this is a valid need, if any way you meet this need in an impure way, it's not valid, it's invalid. Any way you meet this need that is impure is invalid. Young people, men, young men, you have a desire, but your gift is your body for your spouse. And when you give it to another before the wedding day, then you've cheated your spouse out of the gift that God has for you. And every time you go to bed with your spouse, you're bringing that other relationship in memories into that holy matrimony, sacred bedroom. So keep yourself pure. There's a reason for it. There's a reason for it. And I urge you to wait and then marry, and then, like the Bible says, we'd rather marry than burn with lust. Just don't go there. Just don't go there. Honor, and you look at it this way. There's someone you're going to love enough to marry. That's the gift you can give. It's a very holy thing. It's a beautiful thing. And ladies, the same way, you save yourself for your husband. And if you've already blown it, did you hear the song? His love never fails, never gives up. He reaches to you with his forgiveness, but turn from it. Repent, be baptized, follow Jesus, serve God, okay? So it's a legitimate need, but do not get it met illegitimately, men. We talked about how men and women are different, but listen to me. Men get in touch with their emotions through sex. Women get in touch with sex through their emotions. You get that? Did you hear that? And we relate, how we connect. Men get in touch with their emotions through sex, and women get in touch with sex through their emotions. Companionship, sexual intimacy, and honor. It's the number one need in a man's life, honor. The honor. Now I want you to turn to Mark 6. There's a story of Jesus in his own hometown, Mark chapter 6. In Mark chapter 6, it's a powerful passage. You've put it up. I want to read it for you right there in the NIV. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. "Where did this man get these things?" they ask. "What's the wisdom that has been given him that he even does miracles? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son, the brother James and Joseph, Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him, at Jesus. And Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house," look at that, "and in his own house is a prophet without honor." And he could, look at this, not would not do, he could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith, at the lack of the faith of the people in his hometown. Jesus was amazed. He could not do it. Philippians 2 tells us that Jesus, when he came to earth, laid aside his deity. He laid aside the part of him that was God. And he was here fully man. Fully man. Totally opportune to be tempted of the devil. That's why when he overcame the temptation, he did it in the flesh. He conquered sin in the flesh. Not as God, as a man. The temptation was real to him. He was tempted in all points as we are, and yet without sin. And as a man, he did his miracles, anointed by the Spirit of God, where the Bible says he hath anointed him with the Spirit of the Lord. Men, if you want to be great leaders and husbands, you want to greet great wives, we need the fullness of the Spirit, because the flesh and the Spirit are opposite, and we live in the natural too much and not in the supernatural. The Spirit is supernatural. The flesh is natural. Self, kill it. Feed the Spirit. Fast and pray. That's what Jesus did. He fasted. He was a man of fasting. He was a man of prayer, sometimes all night long. And he said, some things just don't happen unless there's fasting and prayer. It's the miracles. The disciples didn't understand why they couldn't do it. And it was by fasting and prayer. By the Spirit, Jesus was able to do what he did. But listen to what happened. He was full of God still. But because in his hometown there was no honor, he couldn't do the miracles he'd done elsewhere. Because the principle of faith still works in prayer. Do you get that? And so they didn't believe in him because he was just another guy. You know, he's just James and Judas's brother. His sisters are here. Mary's his mother. He's from here. They dishonored him. You get that? So let me ask you a question, ladies. Is it possible? Here's the question. If dishonor hindered Jesus when he was a man, could dishonor be hindering your husband from doing great things? Could dishonor be hindering your husband from doing all God wants him to do? It is possible that you're living with a potentially great man who is not being honored. He's not reaching his full potential that God wants for him because he's being dishonored. It's possible. Honor, respect, King James says reverence, but it's honor, it's value. It's the number one need of a husband. Ladies, are you proud of your husband? Do they know it with what you say? Do they know it in how you look? Do they know this? So, and listen, ladies, it's not what you say. You know, if there's something your husband's about to make a mistake or whatever, it's not what you say to them. It's how you say it. It's a lot of times it's how you say it, not what you're saying. Should you speak up if there's an issue? Should you speak up about things? Of course you should. I believe every decision should have a male perspective and a female perspective and should be in unity and agreed together upon. That's what God wants. Remember, before the fall of man, they were mankind. They were humankind. So in case you misunderstand mankind, which means man means humanity. Okay? And I'm just telling you right now that women are valued in the Scripture. There's no male or female. With Christ, he undid that. Heathen religions dishonor women, dishonor females. It's not that way in the Bible. In joint decisions should be made in unity, in joint with the male, a female perspective. And ladies, you should put your opinion out there, but don't do it in the wrong way, because tone and the words you choose can dishonor him. And when a man is dishonored, he will shut down. He will pull away. He will distance himself emotionally. He will not connect with you. The same way, if a man to a woman makes a woman feel insecure and feel like if I don't walking on eggshells, he's going to leave. He's not going to be there. He's going to abandon us. They're going to shut down. It's going to be a problem. They're not going to connect to you physically. They're not going to connect you in a companionship if you're doing that to them. Number one need of a man is to be honored. It's very important. Honor. Jesus, here's the thing. Paul in Ephesians is saying this to you ladies. Listen, women. Treat your man like you would treat Jesus. But here's the problem. He doesn't act like Jesus. Okay, I get it. He doesn't. But here's the thing. Men are kind of like a cork in the bottle in the bottom of a barrel. You know, they're laying there and if you look at them like that and they're no good, they're just on the bottom there, just sitting down there, and that's how you treat them, they're going to always stay down there. But if you start respecting them, honoring them, speaking love and confidence into them and praising them and you know, affirming them and all of that, guess what? It's like putting water in that bucket and that cork begins to rise to the top. And you don't honor him for where he is. You honor him for what you believe him to be. And that's the right thing to do, okay? And that takes laying your life down, ladies. You say, well, he doesn't deserve it. Lay your life down. Do it anyway. There's five love languages in the book. How many of you read the book, Five Love Languages? Physical touch, right? Words of affirmation. Giving gifts. Being thoughtful. They're great gift buyers. Acts of service, doing things for people. My wife gets very excited when I do something like out of the ordinary, you know, like we have the guest over, there's a holiday, and I get up and I do all the dishes and I clean and I cook this and I do that. Or I do something out of the ordinary, like once every year I take the garbage out and bring it in. That type of thing. That excites her, right? She's turned on by that. I'm just telling you. I'm going, kind of right where I want her. No, I'm just saying, acts of service, and some women are love that way. We have different ways that we love, I'm not sure if I mentioned all of them, but anyway, that's what they are. Quality time. Thank you. Quality time. Spending quality time. So, you know, you may have a tendency, the way you love is the way you like to feel love, right? So you have to understand your spouse and lay your life down and go, I'm going to love them in their language. It's not natural, but I'm going to love them in their language. And so, you know, Susan, just to let you know, I want to be touched and I want to be told how great I am. Okay, go ahead. Pour it on, baby. Come on. See you later. She wants me to do acts of service and spend quality time. And a third gift of hers, kind of in order, would be gift giving. She's a very thoughtful, great gift giver. And so that we love in different languages. But the point is when we care enough for our man to love them in their language, we value them. That's what honoring is valuing. Same way with women, you value. You value their godly character. You value their hard work. You value how they work. They love their family. You value the help they do for the family. You value when he's trying to communicate, all those things. And a lot of men feel very honored when their wife communicates that she enjoys her husband's intimacy. That's honoring, right, men? And women want to be cherished no matter what your love language is, men. They want you to cherish and deeply connect in an emotional way, communicate, and be just held with no purpose moving forward. They do not like feeling like an object. They treat them like they're going to go to bed with you, men. Treat your wife like you're going to go to bed with them, because you probably will, okay? And they might just go to bed with you. But treat them all the way, all the time like that. Don't bark at them. Don't be ugly. Now, I remember I said men can be like dogs, right? So when, you know, you're talking about honoring them, when they do a good job, go, good job, boy. Good job. They go, good job. Yeah, good job. That's what male ego, I don't know what it is. We're just made that way, you know? One big surprise to me when we got married is Susan didn't want to wrestle. Anybody else? Find out your wife doesn't want to wrestle. Don't you mess with Elizabeth. She'll take you down and make you say Uncle Walston. I'll tell you that right now. Don't mess with her. And, well, besides Ronda Rousey, she's a different type of woman. But anyway, See, men may be physically strong, they may physically be tough, but they're not tough emotionally. Women are tough emotionally. Words hurt men more than they do women. Why? Because men don't go into deep conversations. We talk about sports, work, cars, food, surface stuff. We don't talk deep. Women talk deep all the time. And they talk so deep, they know each other, they can hit each other emotionally in the stomach with one short sentence. How's it doing, Kathy? Boom. I'm fine, Cindy. Boom. And the man is oblivious. He's going, how are you? What's going on? They don't know nothing. Women are experts at fighting with emotions and hurting men with words. That devalues them. It does not honor them. Guys, be careful what you're doing there. You speak to your husband with dishonoring words or tones, you're slugging him in the stomach emotionally. It really hurts if my wife does that and is not honoring it. It hurts our marriage. Anyone else, hard to hurt me, but not that difficult for her. You can say something hurtful and it rolls off my back. You know, the Bible says about God, he inhabits the praise of his people. How many know it says that he inhabits? Let me put it a different way. What he's saying is God lives in houses that praise him. That's why as a church, we need to be people of praise and honor and glory. Glory and honor to God, right? Honor to God. And we are made as after his own image. Men, listen. It's not praise like we're God. That's not the point. But to be honored by our spouse is a huge need. And so the man is going to live in his house, really live there, and be connected to you in that environment. I remember telling someone this, a woman this one time, and says, you know, your man's not going to, you know, he doesn't live in houses where he's not honored, where he's not lifted up and they're not proud of him. He just doesn't live there. He's lived here 30 years. I said, no, he hadn't. He's lived at the golf course and everywhere else he goes. He just sleeps here. He's not really living with you. He's just sleeping here. There's a big difference, isn't there? Honor your husbands. You know, men will go to the golf course so they can at least hear a good shot. Women need to be cherished, need to feel security. They need the leadership of a godly husband. Men need honor, respect, praise, affirmation. In 1 Peter 3, it says, Sarah called Abraham Lord. That's what Susan calls me around the house. You know, she says, good Lord, why'd you do that? You women, you might be thinking, hey, if I was married to Abraham, that'd be okay, but I'm married to a good old Elmer over here, and old Elmer's about to kill us. I'm not going to call him. You know, but listen, ladies, he'll rise to the level of honor he receives. Honor your husband where you want him to be, not where he is. Honor your husband where you want him to be, not where he is. He will rise to the level of your honoring. It'll change your marriage. Don't cut him down in front of your friends, and don't cut him down when he's not there to your friends. In small groups, women will talk about their husbands and cut them down. And guess what? One of the women goes and tells their husband, oh, so-and-so, he's this and he's that. I can't believe the way he's treating her. He did this and that. And that man goes on the golf course and tells that husband, you know what your wife said about you in Bible study? Happens all the time. Don't do it, ladies. It's dishonoring, even if he doesn't find out. You know, you can say something like, you know, pray for us, you know, pray for my husband, you know, that he has a bigger heart for God and all that. That's different. Be careful. If you're one-on-one, just with the best friend you know that never tell anybody anything, that's a different story. Don't cut him down to your kids. That's the worst thing you can do. Don't cut your husband down to your kids. Don't cut him down to your parents. And don't cut him down to his siblings. Don't cut him down in your family. Worst thing that could happen. Absolute worst thing you can do to dishonor him. And one of the worst things about couples and marriages, and you've been to different things, and we're just creatures of something. I don't know. We just always go back to a lower level or something. We know all this. Maybe we've been to seminars. We know how we should live. We know what we should do. But there's a rebellion. There's a stubbornness. There's a selfishness. There's a pride. There's anger. There's unforgiveness. There's reason we just don't do it. We know we should honor God in tithe and offering, but we just don't do it. There's a rebellion. And I'm going to tell you, a counselor can't fix you. A pastor can't fix you until you get to do what you know what is right to do, and you turn to God, and you ask God to fill you, and you ask his Spirit to fill you. Remember, I told you before, verse 21 in Ephesians 5 is be filled with the Spirit. The answer to being the husband you should be and being a wife, you should be is more of Jesus, more of his spirit, less of you, and less of your flesh. Die to yourself and get to this altar and make it right with God. Will you bow your head with me as we pray? God, we know we can't change anybody. I can't change my spouse. I just want to die to myself daily. Lay my life down for you, Jesus, and lay my pride and anger and selfishness and unforgiveness down for my family, for my friends, for others, to prefer each other in love, God. Thank you, Jesus. We know the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31. She honored her husband, talked about how virtuous she was, and it said that her husband was respected in the gates of the city because she spoke highly of him. He was honored. And Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit would fill us up. We would honor one another, respect one another, prefer one another, love each other, lay our lives down for each other, and be all you want us to be as men and women, though we be different. And some of this is a little bit stereotype of the typical male, typical female. I get that. But I pray, God, that we would not miss the essence of needing to prefer and to lay our lives down and to be a husband that God you've called us to be and be a wife that you called us to be. In Jesus' name.